All right, everybody, we're still getting these guys situated. As we get all these guys kind of lined up back here, I'm Pastor Lewis. I'm the kids' pastor. Some of you guys might not know that yet. But this week, as you can tell from all little sea creatures, the boat and everything, we have just finished VBS. So it's been a very, very fun week and a very tiring and energetic one too. So these guys had a blast. We're going to have them do a song they have done every day this week for you guys. Hopefully y'all enjoy it. And then you kind of see a recap video the whole week after this. So I'm going to turn it over to all these very excited kids to go there and give you guys a little taste of this week.
How awesome is that, church? We had 17 salvations this week. God is moving in our church. Kids are getting saved. That's just something to celebrate. What an awesome week we had at VBS. Hey, kids, at this time, you are dismissed for Kids Church. You can find Pastor Lewis back there. He'll direct you there. But church, at this time, why don't we stand up together today? Let us sing God's praises because he is the hero of heaven. And we don't worship a dead, defeated God, but we worship a God who's risen from the grave, who has overcome death and sin, and who has given us salvation. So let us celebrate all the great things King. Oh, come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. Oh, see what our Savior has done, and see how his love overcomes. He has done great things. Oh, he has done great things.
Seated. Aren't you glad that Christ is one? Amen. Aren't you glad you don't serve a dead, defeated God? Hallelujah. But we serve a risen, resurrected Savior. Man, we're so glad you're here today. Hey, you made it. Welcome to Fincastle Baptist Church. And if it's your first time with us, we're so glad you're here. Right in front of you in the chair back, there's what we call a communication card. We'd love to have a record of your attendance. And as you leave today, there'll be some offering plates in the back, and that can be your gift to us. You can drop that in, and we'll send you a thank you note for being in church today. For those of you that are joining us online, thanks for worshiping with us. You are watching Fincastle Baptist Church in Fincastle, Virginia. We know we have people all over the world that tune in every Sunday. Welcome to worship with us. So glad you're here. Hope as you came in today, you received or picked up a bulletin, and there's a couple of things I want to just highlight for us. Obviously, with Vacation Bible School, we do this a couple times a year. Pastor Lewis will be leading a kids' first steps class. Listen, if your kids have got questions about baptism or church membership or what it really means to be a Christian, there'll be a class tonight. And that same class will be repeated on Wednesday night if you or your child can't make it tonight. Information is in your bulletin. And speaking of baptism, our next baptism is upcoming. And we're actually doing it at the river. And you can see information in your bulletin about an upcoming river baptism. As we go to our prayer time today, I want you to especially pray with me, if you would, for the Strock family, Eric, lost his wife, Ashley, this week. Suddenly, a 38-year-old mom of a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old. There was a blood clot, and she passed away. This is also Nikki and Lynn's daughter-in-law, so you want to pray for that family especially. Would you bow with me? God, we thank you for the words we just sang, that Christ has won and he is victorious. And we thank you that there is victory in Jesus. God, as a church family, we grieve with those who grieve. And so, Father, I pray for the Strock family. I pray your Holy Spirit, who you said was the comforter, would do what he was sent to do. Give comfort to Eric, Nikki, and Lynn, and the rest of the family, God, on this shocking loss of Ashley. Father, I know there are others in our church family that are still grieving the loss of loved ones. And Father, although as believers you tell us that we have the hope of heaven, you say we sorrow, but not like those who have no hope. So we're grateful, Lord, because of Jesus Christ and because of his death, his burial, and his resurrection, that we have the hope of seeing our loved ones that knew you personally again one day. Father, we're thankful for our church. We're so grateful for the life change that we've seen happen this week. We rejoice, God, in what you have accomplished. And we give you praise and honor and glory for that. Thank you, God, for so many that work so hard to make Vacation Bible School possible. And Father, we pray for your favor. We pray for your presence, for your protection, for your power, and for your provision upon the various ministries of our church. We think of our missionaries today. We pray, Father, that you'll give them results, fruit for their labor. We're so grateful. Lord, as we're hearing reports from our Uganda mission trip team and over 270 that made a faith-based decision, receiving Christ as Savior there in Uganda, God, we're grateful for how you work there. And Father, we pray to thank you for the privilege that we have now at this point of the service to give. Lord, we want to be like you, and you're a giver. And so, God, thank you for this opportunity just to demonstrate practically that our faith is real, that you really have changed our lives and made a difference in our life. So, God, we show you that. Demonstrate that one way is through our obedience. Thank you for this opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. On the screens are the various ways you can give to the ongoing ministry of Fincastle Baptist Church. So many of us handle at least part of our finances electronically, and you can see we have that option. And again, as you leave today, there'll be offering plates and offering boxes on the back wall. Well, you picked a great day to be in church. We're continuing our summer series, and I am personally super pumped as we continue our series, The Big Ten. Check out this video. How many of you, by raising your hands, have ever thought this or actually said it out loud? Man, I got so much to do. I just don't know if there are enough hours in the day. You ever thought that? The rest of you just lied in church. Right, we've all thought that, right? I mean, how many of you ever woke up tired? You ever woke up, you're tired, right? Like, I just slept and I woke up. The truth is, so many people today just feel overwhelmed. We're overloaded. We're overcommitted and overextended. We do as much as we can, spend as much as we can, acquire as much as we can so as to get as much as we can out of life. But the Bible has a lot to say about this. We're in this series based on the Ten Commandments, which I'm calling the Big Ten. And if you hadn't already done so, go ahead and open your Bible to Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, and we'll start reading in verse number 8. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 8. Now, if you do not have a hard copy of the Word of God, we've got free Wi-Fi at both our campuses. Hopefully you got a smartphone or a tablet with a Bible app or the church app downloaded on it. And those of you up in Allegheny County at our Highlands campus, good morning. So glad to see you. We're excited to bring Vacation Bible School to the Highlands campus here in just a couple weeks. The end of July, we get to do Splash Kingdom all over again. And I'm super pumped about that. I know many of you have already signed up in advance. And if you hadn't signed up there in the Highlands campus for Vacation Bible School, be sure and do that. Now, just to bring you up to speed where we've been, the first commandment deals with our lives. Remember, it says, don't have any gods before me. The second commandment really deals with our hearts. It talks about how we shouldn't have any idols. And the third commandment, last week that we looked at, deals with our lips and how we're not to take the Lord's name in vain. And the fourth commandment today deals with time. Let's look at Exodus chapter 20. And as always, I'm reading from the 1984 New International Version of God's Word. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. It is so interesting to me that God has more to say about how we use our time than he does about murder or adultery. This is actually the longest of the Ten Commandments. And can I just tell you, personally, I really like this commandment. Part of the reason why I like it is because it's not telling me to do something. It's actually telling me not to do something, okay? But as we've seen through all these Ten Commandments, the truth is we can't keep it. We can't do it. We can't be good enough. We can't be holy enough. We can't be righteous enough. Let me remind you that the Ten Commandments are not a list of rules that we are attempting to keep so as to earn God's approval and blessings. You know, like if I keep God's big ten, you know, he'll bless me more, right? No, as it says on your handout here, the purpose of the Ten Commandments was to show we can't keep them. That's why we need Jesus. We can't keep them. That's why we need Jesus. Hold your finger in Exodus 20 and turn with me to Romans chapter 3. We've been looking at this text every week. Romans chapter 3. Paul is writing to the church of Rome, and he says in verse 12, there is no one who does good, not even one. Verse 20, therefore no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. What is he saying? He's saying no one can keep the law. We can't keep the Ten Commandments, but even if we could, no one will be declared righteous by keeping the law, keeping the Ten Commandments. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. Verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. I love what Paul said in chapter 7 of Romans. I wouldn't have known what sin was except through the law or the Ten Commandments. He said, for instance, I wouldn't have known what coveting was if the Ten Commandments, the law, didn't say do not covet. You see, we can never meet God's requirements in the Ten Commandments. They show our hopelessness to get to heaven apart from Jesus. And this fourth commandment particularly is hard because the only thing more difficult than being told what to do is being told to do nothing at all. Or to say it another way on your handout, sometimes the hardest thing to do is to do nothing. Some of you are elbowing your spouse right now. You see, what God is reminding us of with this fourth commandment is that one day can make all the difference. Man, have I learned that this year. January 11th, 2022 will always be a day I remember because it made a huge difference in my life. You see, that was the day, if you don't know my story, I was helping my son and his family move to Little Rock, Arkansas, and on that day, unloading the back of a U-Haul, a car came through the apartment complex parking lot and ran me over and basically pinned me from the front of his bumper to the back of the U-Haul. And 4 leg surgeries later and a whole bunch of therapy, I'm proud to say I'm now able to stand up. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah. Now, the problem is I just can't stand up for the entire length of the sermon, all right? But I'm getting there. I'm getting there, all right? But one day can make a difference. I mean, you know this, right? Think of your own life. Think of maybe the day you got married, or the day you graduated school, or the day you got the job, right? Or the day you made the team, or the day your kids were born, right? Or the day you found Christ and got saved, the day you got baptized, right? One day can make all the difference. Now, speaking of one day and the difference that one day can make, this past Friday, June 24th, was a big day for our nation as our Supreme Court rightly interpreted the Constitution and overturned Roe v. Wade. Now, I'll be honest with you, I never thought I'd see this in my lifetime. I didn't. I mean, it's a day many people have prayed for decades, and it's touched off all kind of discussion and debate, all kind of demonstrations and reaction, and unlike, just like every other issue, I want to remind you, as I have for the last nearly 25 years as your pastor, there is no debate when you read the Bible. There is no debate. The Bible is crystal clear on this subject as it is on every other subject. The Bible is clear that life begins at conception. And the Bible is clear. Jeremiah 1:5 says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you." And Psalm 139 says that your hand shaped me and made me. I'm fearfully, wonderfully made. But as Christians, as Bible followers, this is not a time for us to gloat. While we're thankful with this decision, it should inspire us even more to be the hands and feet of Jesus to the ones who are fearful and alone and scared with an unwanted pregnancy. This should inspire us to continue to pray for those who work, as many from our church family do, in crisis pregnancy centers. And as I say every time when I talk about this subject, listen, if you're under the sound of my voice and you either have had an abortion or you have encouraged an abortion, and I know with the amount of people listening to me right now, this is undoubtedly several people. I want to remind you that with Jesus, there is forgiveness. With Jesus, there is restoration. With Jesus, there is hope. And while I'm on this subject, how in the world can our self-described Catholic president so ignore not only the clear teachings of the Bible, but the clear teachings of his own Catholic Church? How in the world can he do that? And you know how he can? I thought about this all week. You know how he can? Here's the answer, and you're not going to like it. The same way you and I ignore the clear teachings of Scripture. For instance, this is the only commandment we brag about breaking. This is the only commandment we brag about breaking. How you doing? We used to answer fine. Now we answer busy. Man, I'm busy. I'm busy at work. I'm busy with the kids. I'm busy at church. I'm busy telling people how busy I am. I'm just busy. It's almost like there's this shame attached to rest. It's like we feel guilty for taking a break. There's something about resting or taking a break that seems almost unrighteous or wrong. And technology's only made this worse, right? God has something to say about your and my pace of life. Because most of us, if we continue in the frantic, hectic pace we are living, we're headed for trouble. Quite frankly, we're headed for a burnout. And I'm not talking about the kind the NASCAR driver does after he wins the race. See, we don't even know how to rest anymore. We think, well, we need more time. Man, I just need more time. What if God decided tonight, because nobody likes Monday anyway, I'm going to give you 25 hours tomorrow. Instead of just 24, tomorrow's going to be 25 hours. What would you do with it? Would you spend it resting, sleeping in a little bit, taking a nap? Or would you spend it catching up on all the things you got to do? What if God decided, hey, you know what? Look, it's been a busy week down there on earth. Next week's going to have 8 days. Instead of 7, I'm going to give you 8. What would we all do with it? Spend that extra day with our family? Spend that extra day with God? Or would we spend that extra day catching up on all the things we've got? See, the answer's not more time. The answer isn't even using our time more wisely. You know, I just need to take a time management class. No, the answer is using my time God's way, because only that will prevent burnout. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. How do I avoid burnout? So let's look, number one, at the requirements of this commandment. Because a lot of people misunderstand this commandment. They think there's actually one requirement, but there's actually two requirements. And let me give you the one first that we all miss, okay? A, we are commanded to work. Look what it says in verse 9. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Work is not part of the curse. But as a result of the sin, in Genesis chapter 3, we're told that our work now will be hard. Our work will be difficult. It'll be frustrating. Work is not bad. It's good. Newsflash, it's one of the things you're going to do in heaven. In heaven, you're not going to sit on a cloud for all eternity strumming a harp. That's not heaven anyway, by the way. One of the things we're going to do in heaven is work. Work is a privilege. The ability to work and earn a living is a blessing from God. But problem today. Our problem today is many people won't work because the government will pay them to stay home and not work. Listen to what 1 Timothy 5 says. If a man doesn't provide for his family, he's denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Look at the verse on your handout. If a man will not work, he shall not eat. Why don't we write a law on that one? But most of the people listening to me right now, that's not our problem. Our problem is the other extreme. Most of us, the other extreme is we tend to be workaholics. And God takes this idea of rest so seriously as he does murder and adultery and stealing. But again, it's the only commandment we brag about breaking. But God is interested in your pace of life. He's interested in your schedule. He's interested in your rest and your recreation. He's commanded us to work, but B, we are also commanded to rest. Look at the verse on your handout. It's senseless for you to work so hard from early morning until late at night. God wants his loved ones to get their proper rest. God is saying, limit your labor. God is saying, if you don't take a break, you're going to break down. God is saying, if you don't take a day off, you're going to be off. God is saying, if you don't come apart and rest, you're going to come apart, because our best requires rest. Well, what is a Sabbath anyway? Well, on your handout there, number one, the Sabbath is actually a day of rest. And the purpose was to prevent burnout, to rest physically, emotionally, spiritually, to get recharged. Now, when is the Sabbath? Is it on Saturday? Is it on Sunday? The truth is, it doesn't really matter. Now, in this time and in Jesus' day, the Sabbath was Saturday. The Sabbath is and has always been on Saturday. Then what are we doing here today? Well, you see, once Jesus rose from the dead, early believers started meeting together on the first day of the week, on Sunday, to celebrate his resurrection. And if you really want to be technical about it, and if you really want to put on your theological thinking cap for a second, number two, we are really no longer under the Sabbath. Look at the verses on your handout. Now that faith has come, we're no longer under the supervision of the law. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you with regard to a Sabbath day, These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. In Romans 14, Paul said, every day alike belongs to God. What is he saying? Pick one day and keep it holy. What's that mean? Different, separate. Now, we still need a measure of respect for Sunday. We don't have to keep all the rules of the Old Testament Sabbath, but do you know, as you study the history of our nation, how far are we fallen? Do you know that when the Mayflower reached Plymouth Harbor, it was actually late Saturday afternoon? And even though the Pilgrims had been on the Atlantic for 13 weeks, tossing and turning, what they did was something amazing. They didn't get off the boat, but actually stayed on the boat and spent all day Sunday in worship and rest. And actually, when they disembarked, they had been here for 42 hours. Do you know the story of President Zachary Taylor? President-elect Zachary Taylor was scheduled, according to the Constitution then, to take the oath of office at 12 noon on March 4th. The problem was, that was a Sunday, and the deeply religious Zachary Taylor said, I'm not going to do it. Now, the Constitution forbid the previous president, James Polk, from staying another day, so there was no alternative, but the Senate had to elect someone to be president for that 24-hour period. And so they selected a guy named David Rice Akeson, who was head of the Senate. But during the time of inauguration, things were so busy for all the senators, Senator Akeson actually went home early there on Sunday afternoon and slept most of the day and slept right all through Monday at noon. So the man slept through his entire one-day presidency. Not much has changed in our nation. Now, number two, what's the reasons for this commandment? I mean, why has God got this in the Ten Commandments? And why is this such a big deal anyway? I mean, why has he put it there? Well, there's several reasons. A, the first is to reflect on God. God is saying, I want you to take one day a week and specifically reflect. What are we to reflect on? Number one, on his pattern. Look what he says in verse 11. For in 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. Then he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. God constantly reminds the people and reminds us in scriptures that is he who created the heavens and the earth. He says, remember. Remember, when God finished his great week of creating, he paused to reflect on what he'd done. He didn't need the rest. He wasn't tired or worn out, but he was setting a pattern for us to follow. Exodus 31 says the Sabbath was a sign, a reminder for the children of Israel. We're to reflect, number two, on his provisions, to reflect on all he had done. Remember, he'd given these commandments to Moses. Moses gives them to the people. And they were to reflect on what God had just brought the nation through the Red Sea, as we just sang about. God had just delivered them from slavery. See, Sunday's a good day for us to step back, take a minute and reflect on all God's provisions to us and all his blessings. Number three, we're to reflect on his promises. As I think about the upcoming week, and I think about Monday, and all the responsibility and all the pressure and all the deadlines, we need to reflect on God's promises, his promise to be with us, his promise to meet our needs, his promise to strengthen us. Why has God got that? What are the reasons to reflect on God? B, to refocus our spirit. It's all week you and I are up against it, right? We battle the world, we battle our own fleshly desires, we battle actually Satan himself, the Bible teaches, and it can wear us down. And we need an oasis of encouragement, and guess what? That's what the church is supposed to be. a place to help us refocus our lives, refocus our priorities as we come here together corporately and we sing the songs of faith, and it helps us refocus our thoughts. You see, number one, this happens when we worship. That's why Hebrews 10 says, do not neglect meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. Look, I'm so thankful for technology. And I'm thankful that we were broadcasting our services long before any of us had heard of the word COVID. But there's nothing like being here. There's nothing like gathering with the people of God, fellowshipping with the people of God, and singing praises for the glory of God. And worship puts my problems in perspective. And here's the truth. The time you spend in church is so small. It's less than 1% of your week. Well, Pastor Kevin, I only miss church occasionally. Do you only murder occasionally? Do you only commit adultery occasionally? You see, our unwillingness to do it God's way and to take a Sabbath is basically saying, I am so important, I got so much to do, I'm holding up the world. Can I be blunt? You can resign as general manager of the universe. A job has already been taken. See, a reluctance to rest is actually a sign of immaturity. Think of your kids if you got small kids at home, or remember back when you had small kids at home. Did they like to go to bed on time? Of course not. No kid wants to go to bed on time. So every night you go through this argument, don't you? And they think of ways to delay bedtime because they don't want to rest. But any wise parent knows that if they don't get their kids to bed on time, things are not going to be good the next day. Sometimes as the wise parent, you've got to force them to go to bed. Sometimes, as I've learned, our Heavenly Father has to make us lie down in green pastures. See, this happens, number two, when we fellowship and when we serve. Life is better connected with God and connected with other believers. And we all know when we serve others, it refocuses our spirit. It gets our thoughts off of us and our problems and our needs and our wants and our desires on other people. And number three, it happens when we pray. That's why Jeremiah wrote, call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things you do not know. Now, here's the third reason for this commandment. The third reason is that I would recharge. We would recharge our emotions. Because many of us are more emotionally tired than we are physically tired. So what should I do? Number one, I should include a time for quietness. The most famous psalm, Psalm 23. He leads me beside the noisy waters. That's not what it says, right? He leads me beside the quiet waters. We live in a world of noise pollution. And part of your Sabbath needs to be some quiet time. The tragedy is many people never take a day off. And if they actually take a day off from work, they fill their day off from work up with other things. Travel ball, kids sports, chores. And we ignore one of our most important things, our emotional need for rest. Your spirit needs to be recharged. So number two, you include time for family. Because all through American history, Sunday used to be historically known for two things, church and family. Ecclesiastes 9, enjoy life with your wife whom you love. Proverbs 14, 30, a relaxed attitude lengthens a person's life. You want to live a long time? Chill out. That's what he's saying. And number three, include some time for fun. Jesus said in John 10, I've come that you might have life and life to its full. Proverbs 17, 22, being cheerful keeps you healthy. Here's the problem. When we think of recharging, we think of plugging something in. I need to recharge my device. Need to recharge my phone. When actually many of us to recharge maybe need to unplug some things. Amen. D, we rest our body. That's the fourth reason for this commandment, is to actually rest our body. Let me use this illustration. When you eat at a fast food restaurant, why do you do it? I mean, not because the food's good. You do it because it's fast, right? I mean, you get in, you get out, right? That's why you go to a fast food restaurant. You get in, you get out, you get the food, right? You eat it as God intended in the car. Hallelujah. Now, when you go to a nice restaurant, maybe for your anniversary, maybe for a special occasion, what do? You take some time there. You enjoy the surroundings. You enjoy the people you're with. You take in the ambiance. And that's what God is saying. I want you to take a day to take it all in. So how do I respond? Number three, how do I respond practically to this commandment? Well, I've given it to you. I've got to learn to relax God's way. Here's the problem. Most of us can't relax. Most of us can't imagine having time to give our kids undivided attention without thinking about what to pick up for dinner or a deadline at work. Most of us can't imagine what it's like to rest. I mean, really rest emotionally without being distracted about the laundry that needs to be done or the honey-do list you got to finish. Most of us can't relax. We can't imagine time to really connect with our spouse rather than just share information. Hey, what time is practice? Don't forget about back to school night. Hey, did you remember to? I love how one author put it. We live in a time-starved society that relentlessly pushes us to the limit. Buy more, do more, accomplish more, rush, 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 hurry, hurry, hurry. We're always trying to be more productive, more efficient, more expedient, more, more, more. It's crazy what passes for a normal family schedule today. The kids are overwhelmed, and 4 or 5 nights a week, we're cramming extracurricular activities. We're always rushed, always on the move. We never have enough time. Again, most of us are living at a pace that's not only, that's unsustainable, but quite frankly, it's unbiblical. So we have to look at verse 8, keep it holy. How do I do that? Holy means different. It means set apart. It means unique. What is God saying here? He's saying you do not have to keep all the Old Testament rules. Here's the problem. The Jewish leaders made this day, the Sabbath day, such a burden that the people dreaded it. The Pharisees added to the scripture. There were approximately 1,521 things you were not allowed to do on the Sabbath. Let me give you some. For example, you couldn't rescue a drowning person on the Sabbath. That'd be considered work. You couldn't untie knots with 2 hands. If you could do it with 1 hand, it was permissible. If a man's ox fell into the ditch, he could pull it out. But if the man fell in, he had to stay there all night. My personal favorite. If you were being bitten by a bug, you couldn't kill the bug. You had to allow the bug to keep biting you, because if you killed the bug, according to the Pharisees, that would be hunting on the Sabbath. Obviously, this is why Jesus often clashed with the Pharisees. And Jesus came along and taught us that it's not about keeping a bunch of rules, that it's about a relationship. So how do I do that? How do I keep it holy? How do I relax God's way? Well, big shock here. I'm going to give you an acrostic. All right, are you ready? A, R, I got to realize my worth. Realize my worth. You see, most people overwork because we confuse our work with our worth. We think if we work a lot, achieve a lot, then we're worth a lot. We confuse with what we do with who we are. This is especially a problem for American men. Because especially American men, after we meet one another, after I find, the first question we normally ask one another is your name, and what's the second question we ask? Hey, what do you do? I did it this morning. I did it to several of you this morning. Hey, what do you do? But the Bible teaches who you are is more important than what you do. Now, again, we are to work. We're just to work differently. Number one, we're to work from acceptance, not like I'm trying to earn my acceptance by what I do in my occupation. We're to work from love, not for love. I'm not trying to earn acceptance and love. Number three, we're to work from security, not for security. And then B, to relax God's way, I've got to E, enjoy what I already have. Ecclesiastes 3. All of us enjoy what we've worked for it's a gift. 1 Timothy 6, but godliness with contentment is great gain. We brought nothing into this world, and we will take nothing out. You see, what we do is we try to keep up with our neighbors, the Joneses. Now, we don't realize they've just refinanced for the third time, and they're on the edge of bankruptcy, but we're trying to keep up with them. Are you ready for a newsflash today? Every one of us in this room, I dare say the vast majority of people under the sound of my voice, are you ready? You are stinking loaded. You're rich. You go, what? I don't feel rich. That's the problem. We don't feel rich. But do you understand, compared to the world, every one of us are in the top 5% of the wealthiest people in the world. You're rich. You're loaded. The problem is we don't feel that way, do we? I feel like, man, I'm just struggling. That's why I love mission trips. We go to mission trips, and we go overseas, and we encounter believers who are living with a dirt floor, and they have something we don't have. They have joy unspeakable. You see, I gotta enjoy what I already have. I love what Paul said in Philippians 4. I've learned the secret of being content. What is he saying? It's something I've got to learn, and it's a secret. Not a lot of people figure it out. Not a lot of people know it. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every circumstance. That doesn't mean I don't work hard. That doesn't mean I don't try to improve myself. But see, I've got to limit my labor. God put this right up there with don't kill, don't commit adultery. 6 days you shall labor. On the seventh day you should. I love the story of the first grader who became curious because her father always brought home a briefcase full of papers every night from his office. And the first grader asked mom about it, and mom said, well, daddy has so much to do that he can't finish it all at the office. That's why he's got to bring home work every night. To which this innocent first grader asked, why don't they put him in a slower group? You see, D, I've got to adjust my priorities. If I'm going to relax God's way, I've got to adjust my priorities. 2 Corinthians 8, they gave themselves first to the Lord. Matthew 6, seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. And then E, I've got to exchange. I've got to exchange my busyness for God's peace. I love what Jesus asked once. Matthew 8, what good is it? Have you gained the whole world? Lose your own soul. You see, when you don't do it God's way, you're chronically fatigued, you're always tired, you're out of balance, but when you do it God's way, you benefit physically, emotionally, mentally, relationally, spiritually. You need more than a vacation. A week at the beach is great, but unless you actually exchange your busyness for God's peace, you're going to come back to the same deadlines and same schedule and same commitments. How many of you, I've said this before, I've come back from vacation and felt like I needed a vacation from my vacation because I came back to all the stuff. Now, many of us want to do it. See, exchanging my busyness for God's peace simply starts with me saying, God, I need your help. I dare say the vast majority of us want to do it. We want to slow down. We want to relax God's way. We just don't know how to start. I love this translation on your handout of what Jesus said. Are you tired? Worn out? Burned out? Come to me. Get away with me. And you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. You see, number one, the antidote to burnout is obedience. Again, our best requires rest. Our best requires rest. The antidote to burnout is obedience. But some of you can't really relax, and quite frankly, you shouldn't relax. Because number two, you can't really relax and you shouldn't relax unless you have a relationship with Jesus. Again, it's not about keeping the rules. It's about knowing God, Jesus Christ, personally. Have you done that? How do I do that? It's as simple as ABC. I admit that I need God. I admit that I have sinned and broken his rules. B, I believe. I believe that he died on the cross, he was buried, and he rose from the dead. But it's not enough to just believe that intellectually. The Bible says the demons believe that. We know they're not going to heaven. No, see, I've got to call on the name of the Lord. I've got to confess my sin, call out to him, and ask him to come into my heart and my life. If you've never done that, today is your day. You see, even if you have done that, the truth is, number three, we need more than time management. You need more than a time management class. We need a new manager. We need a new manager. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus.